Wing and the Humidity, we decided, let's see if we can get some Hong Kong weather for you guys. So we've had a rollicking week with mayhem, and now we switch gears and get international. Now we've got a film from Hong Kong. As many of you might know, I'm a huge fan of Hong Kong films. Action films, comedies, martial arts films, and of course, there are horror films. And in around 1983, there was a seminal classic which came out of Hong Kong called Mr. Vampire. Produced by Samuel Hahn, who was here on this stage for SPL. And the interesting thing is, the way that I kind of got into the film festival is I wrote a fanzine. Remember fanzines? Remember Xerox fanzines? I wrote a fanzine about Hong Kong cinema. And because I was, when I saw Chinese Ghost Story 2 at the film festival, I was hooked right away. And I go into Chinatown, and I'd be the lone white guy going out there asking for all these weird films. They stared at me all the time. And I discovered these films, and I just started writing about them in a fanzine. And one of the issues, the second issue I did, I only got off my ass to do 2 issues of it. I did an essay on the history of Hong Kong vampire films. Because in Hong Kong films and Mr. Vampire, they're not like Western vampires, they hop. Sammo Hung always wanted to do a horror film, wanted to do a vampire film, but unfortunately Chinese traditional vampires aren't really screen friendly. They're kind of green and hairy and smell and just don't do too much. And so Sammo Hung was inspired by the Hammer Dracula films, and he created a cinema mythology of the hopping vampire. And there was Mr. Vampire 1, Mr. Vampire 2, Mr. Vampire 3, Mr. Vampire 4, New Mr. Vampire, there were TV series, it just spawned this craze in the 1980s. And this director saw Mr. Vampire when he was 7 years old, and it changed his life. And he's written and directed this film. It's a loving, moody tribute to these dark, strange Chinese cinema vampires. And he has a lot of the original actors in the original film, and it's produced by the director of The Grudge. So, you know you're going to get some creeps in there. So, I'd like to introduce you, and I also want to point out that the first time I met him the other day when he showed up to the Midnight Madness reception, he was actually dressed like a vampire hunter. In robes and beads, and I want you to put your hands together for Juno Mack.
Thanks for coming here tonight. And you know, I grew up in Vancouver, and well, it's my first time in Toronto, and I love this city. So hope you guys enjoyed the film, and it meant so much to me, and it's my honor to be able to share this film with you. Thank you very much.
Let's hear it for Juno Mack. We introduce to you a brilliant visual stylist, Juno Mack.
I was sitting up there, and I had a great time kind of sharing the film with you guys, and you know, rigor mortis was never intended to be a battling type of film. It's sort of, for me, it's a film about life. I focused the film based on the fear of being forgotten for this cast of mine. I think the hopping vampire genre, it not only represents a big part of my childhood. It also represented the golden age of basically Hong Kong cinematic history. So, you know, I'm really grateful that I was given this chance to revisit this genre. Yeah, thank you.
Is the lead actor, Chin Soo Ho. He was the
the hero of the first Mr. Vampire film. Basically, your whole kind of cast with all these faces from those films. How was it? How did you reach out to them, and how did they react? When I mean, Chin Soo Ho hasn't really. He was like kind of a big star in the 80s, and then his star just kind of faded, very much like that in the your story. How did they react when you approached them and said, "Be in my film"?
Well, actually, you know, a big part of it is obviously fictional. Actually, Chin Soo Ho, he's living very happily now. We gave him a very sad and tragical background. But, you know, it meant so much to me because in the original, sadly, two of the most important cast, they passed away. And basically, Chin Soo Ho, he's the last one left from the main character. You know, some of them left the business, a lot of them retired. So when I contacted them, I believe there's a certain amount of love they have for this particular genre. So that's, you know, finding them is the most hardest part, you know, because since they're not active anymore. But by seeing them, I think all the wrinkles on their face, they are beautiful to me. And they represented a big part of Hong Kong cinematic history. Basically, the faces where you haven't seen for many years already. So it is hard, but you know, I don't expect Richard, who played the vampire, to be running around at this age.
He was a huge comedy star in the 1970s and in the early 80s. And then Anthony Chan, who plays the speckled Taoist priest, he was in a pop group called The Winners. They were all big stars in the 80s. Now, the other thing that I want to ask you about is you've got a very particular look to the whole production. There's an incredible style to it, from the design to all the effects and kind of like just the whole spirit world. Can you talk about your inspiration for that or how you pursued that and work with the team?
It's a very tough shoot. Actually, I believe there's you know, there's zombies and there's vampires in America and Europe, but Hong Kong hopping vampire really represented a big part of Hong Kong. So it's been gone for almost 30 years now, and by being able to revisit the genre, I really want to evolve with the genre. So we have over 600 CGI shots, and we did a whole lot amount of research on the whole hopping vampire genre and how do we fit into a more heavy drama that evolves around human emotions. So the visuals you just saw, we worked on it for a year during post. We shot it for 3 months, and the pre-production was half a year. So actually we spent a very long time for a Hong Kong production film to finish this film. Yeah.
Because when I saw it, it was so rough and raw, so really I'm seeing it with all the layered effects, it's just magical. And can you talk about, so I mentioned before, the producer was Takeshi Shimizu, the director of The Grudge. What was his involvement and his kind of guidance in the film?
Well, I met him in Japan, and I believe that he was really interested in the story, because it is based on a horror genre, but it is not a pure horror film. He's really interested in the human emotions, in the relationship among the characters. So that's why he got on board the story. But you know, he's a great director and a great friend that he never really controlled my freedom in creating the story, how I shot it, or how the editing will be. Shimizu-san, he helped a lot with the post-production, let's say the sound designs, and how the effects will be like, and the coloring. So, you know, I think we work as a great team, that we're quite separated. You know, I'm directing the film, and he's so that's how we met in Japan, yeah.
Any questions from the audience? Yes?
I wanted to ask about the effects. Being
fight scene at the end is like, it's very elaborately choreographed. How long did that take?
Oh my god, that took like a very long time. That took around 20 days. We shot the film, we finished the film in 60 days, or almost 70. So the fight scene with the hand thing, that is a pain in the ass. We spent so much time on it, and I'm really happy that we got this special makeup artist from Thailand. His name is Q. He worked on the special effects on Drive and Only God Forgives. So he's a great makeup artist. So that is a mechanical hand, and actually it's all built, and it has metal in it, and it can twist and break and everything, and it could be redone again and again. So that's how we did it.
And there was a question, yes? Is the kid with the white hair an homage to any other kind of film?
No, actually, I just thought it would be really beautiful to have this albino boy. Actually, we tried to cast an albino boy, but it's really hard to get them in Hong Kong. They're really protected. And we went to Taiwan for it, and they're heavily protected as well. So we cast this really talented kid, and it feels really bad for him, seeing him every single day. He has to be on set and does this 3-hour long makeup, put on the wig and everything, and having to be torn apart by the vampire. It's more like a visual thing that I wanted. I always thought that, the color white is really beautiful in them, so that's why I placed a character in it. It also stands for the purity, the innocence of humanity.
Question, yes.
Like you, I grew up with Mr. Vampire series, and thank you so much for bringing back the high-tech version. One thing I want to ask you is that, as you probably know, the reason that Mr. Vampire series is so popular is the lightheartedness of it as well. That's the humor behind it that makes it so popular. In this version, there's a lot more drama into it, and it's a lot more seriousness, even though that with Anthony Chan, he's still got that as a comedic ability. Can you talk a little bit more about your decision to make it more of a dramatic homage to Mr. Ben, as opposed to a more lighthearted comedic world in that role?
Well, that's a great question. To be honest, it's more like a personal take on it. I don't think I'm pretty much a humorous guy, so I'm not good with it. But anyway, I believe that it's been gone for 30 years, and a lot of genre like this evolves along the time. We got zombies and vampires. I'm sure you know how much they've changed throughout the years. But hopping vampire is different. It stopped 30 years ago, and by able to revisit the genre, I want to give it a different take. And I believe that comedic element is not what I wanted in the first place, to be able to express a story like this. In a story, I just want to express the love human have for each other. How things are put together, as in fate, how it started off as an accident, and how much you do and how far you go when a certain situation comes up. So you get a lot of different relationship, a lot of feelings in the film, and I think that's pretty much it filled up the whole film. So I think the comedic humorous element is not what I wanted in this version and how I see this genre. Right.
Yes.
Right.
The song in the film is kind of like the theme of Mr. Vampire. But as soon as you hear that, it just sparks the memories.
But my question is that, like, is set, do you have certain either council
location was it set on, like council houses in Hong Kong?
There's 20% that we shot and with the exterior, that's real, but almost 80% of it, it's all built up and set because we did a lot of location scouting and the place was beautiful. But we have a lot of technical problems, you know, with the housing and the real estate in Hong Kong with the public housing. It's good to look at, but if you want to shoot a film there, it's basically too small. You just can't put your camera in it, and not even mentioning the action you have in there. So that's it, like 20% is real and 80% of them are built.
We've got time for one last question. So the question is, what you might not know is, Juno's also a pop singer in Hong Kong. And the question is, why aren't your songs in the film?
Thank you, I'm flattered, but it seems like two different things. I'm glad you like my songs, but I just thought like, with this genre, with that theme song, it's called The Ghost Bride, and it's so iconic, and I don't think my song would fit perfectly well with it.
When's your next album coming out?
Wow, it's getting personal now. Actually, I just finished my new album, but I don't have time to release it yet because we just flew in from Venice a while ago. So please wait, it's coming.
And you should check out if you do go to the Midnight Madness blog, we actually just put up my essay from 1991 about the history of Hopping Vampires. And we've got some other information on Hopping Vampires. So let's put your hands together for Mr. Juno Lack.